Well,
I want to thank the
Women's Club for holding this forum. This is a great opportunity. I've been to this room many times while living here in Roswell. I've lived here in Roswell since 1999. My family relocated over from Smyrna when we decided to choose the best schools in the Atlanta area for our children. I have three children, one of which turned 18 today and took his privilege to vote today. And so they are out celebrating his birthday. And next week we have another celebration in the family, my 26th wedding anniversary. So I will be happy to do that next week. Professionally, I started life as an aerospace engineer at Georgia Tech. I designed aircraft for our nation's military. And while working at Lockheed, I discovered the internet and started an entrepreneurial group and started my own internet company. Went out on my own. IBM coaxed me away. And I had a large group at IBM that I then was managing some large financial transaction websites, such as the first online banking website for Bank of America. I also then was moved on to EES, and then I decided to take some time off from the corporate world and decided to do some landscape, do some real estate development. So I have some real estate experience. I've actually been before here in a variance hearing. So I have variance experience, engineering experience, IT experience, and I'm a pilot. I understand aviation. All these things come into great asset when you sit as a commissioner to understand what the things are before you. But the biggest experience is serving on the board of Cobb EMC, one of Roswell's largest electrical providers. I serve as the chairman of the finance committee and oversee a $426 million budget, and I have the experience, the only one in this race, of reducing budgets down $42 million. And we've also reduced staff, and we've also lowered rates and affected people's wallets. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm going to take care of a little housekeeping. First of all, we're missing two of our incumbents this evening. Commissioner John Eaves is not here, but Mr. Rob Pitts, Commissioner Pitts, has sent regrets. His child is graduating from Vanderbilt University. And I also want to make a comment that I did not want to imply that politicians did not need college degrees. They certainly do. And another comment, those people that cannot be here tonight, and I did receive some emails about this, can see this tonight on YouTube. It will be posted, and many of you who are in the room and who just went through this will want to see yourselves. So the city is going to post this on YouTube on Monday, and we will try to get the link sent out through social media. And candidates, you might want to post that also and share it with people. So thank you very much, and we'll try to get that expressed.
Some of you won't want to see yourself.
I'm speaking for you, Hal. All right, we're going to start the questioning with this question, and we'll go in order. In view of the incorporation of virtually all of Fulton County, which duplicate services would you eliminate? Let's start with you, Mr. Cooper.
Well, first of all, Fulton County, we still have a part that's not incorporated, if I understand your question. We do have 14 cities here. What we do need to do and focus in on is making sure that South Fulton decides on if it's going to be a city or not, if I understand your question there. We do need to make sure that we get good leadership, which will cut on the cost of the overall cost of the general fund, giving them the opportunity to form a city.
Thank you. And by the way, you have 2 minutes to answer each question, so please take as much time as you need to answer it completely. Mr. Ellis, would you like me to repeat the question?
Sure.
In view of the incorporation of virtually all of Fulton County, which duplicate services would you eliminate?
Well, it's not all incorporated. So, you have counties required to provide those city services into that particular area. So it's about 87,000 people in that particular area. So until such a point in time that that is municipalized, the county's required to provide those services in there. I would go on record and say I think it would be great if we could municipalize the rest of the county and get the county out of the city services business. And then that, then you clearly would have duplicity, and then you can remove those particular services related to police, fire, zoning, et cetera, that a city could provide. You know, we've done away with a lot of duplicity at the moment in terms of the newer cities that have been formed, you know, through the use of, and you know, there's still some use of some IGAs and that sort of stuff, but I think a lot of the duplicity on the northern end has been eliminated at this point in time. But it's a great opportunity. If we can get the rest of the county municipalized and get out of the city services business.
Thank you. Mr. Broadwell.
Thank you, Lynn. If we can incorporate the rest of the county, the goal would be to eliminate various services. One of them is Parks and Rec. There are no county parks here in North Fulton. They're only in South Fulton. And so our money pays for South Fulton Park Services. So if we can incorporate the rest of it, those parks can then be rolled into those cities down in the south side. The other is police services. We have to provide safety services to the unincorporated area. That would then roll into a city service as well. So the goal would be to get the county completely incorporated so we could get out of the services of providing these things to the south portion that's unincorporated. The other things that we need to look at is also around transportation and how our transportation money is being spent. There are roads that they're using North Fulton transportation money and building roads in the unincorporated area saying, well, these roads can be used by everybody. But we all know we're not going to go down there and drive on them. So there are many opportunities for various things to be eliminated if you can incorporate the whole county, which would be a great thing, I think, for the county. We could then reduce our budget and lower our county taxes accordingly. We also need to look at things such as there's three payroll systems. We need to roll those into one and outsource it. There's lots of opportunity for duplicity that's within the county government that I've been discovering. So you'll always find for me specific solutions and specific answers. I won't speak at a high level. I've been investigating, I've been doing my due diligence, and I'm going to make sure I chase down what I can to make sure that we're spending our money correctly.
Thank you.
This question is for Bob Ellis, beginning with you. There has been much discussion in recent years about the formation of Milton County. Do you support those efforts? And please explain your answer.
Sure. Well, the concept of Milton County, I do support the concept, and I would like nothing better to be a one-term commissioner and be the last set of commissioners from North Fulton County, Milton County Commission. The county, quite honestly, is a pretty complex county. I think all of you know that in terms of demographically, geographically, and economically. But the reality of it is that that's not on the table right now. There are a tremendous amount of legislative hurdles that would need to play out for that to take place. So my focus right now is making Fulton County as good as it can be. And we've got a great opportunity before us with three seats from North Fulton for the first time ever. And Milton County's gonna play out like it's gonna play out, but my focus is making Fulton County as good as it can be.
Thank you. Gary Broadwell.
Thank you, Al. I do support the formation of Milton County. And the goal of coming in as a commissioner and having the new representation is to set the county on firm financial footing. And we have to do that with hard choices, making budget cuts where we can, combining departments where we can, reducing staff where we can. And the other thing we need to do is we need to look at how our government is centralized right now. If we can decentralize it so that maybe some of us, when we go to court, we don't have to go all the way down to Prior Street. If we decentralize the county government, we can then set it up for a very easy split into the three governments that would eventually become South Fulton, Milton, and Atlanta City government, so that Atlanta City then owns its own government within that area. There is a lot of hurdles to go over. I know Jan Jones has been working on this for years, and I've been a big supporter of that. I've actually moved the county line myself. I'm the only individual in the state of Georgia that's moved the county line. My property straddled Fulton County. And I actually moved the county line and put my property all into Fulton County. And so I think I can get things done. And I think we can make this happen. And it's just going to take a lot of support and some good leadership.
Thank you. Earl Cooper, how do you feel about Fulton County?
Remember, I'm not against these guys, okay? We're all on the same team here. Let me share this. One of the reasons why that has come up is because there's been a lack of leadership at the county. I think that if we, thank you, ma'am. I think if we focus in on good leadership, then we can focus in on being one county. Certain things that we do have to take into consideration. The last thing we need is more government. And having more government means more laws. That's a whole different set of startups and elections and things that will cost us, and it might not be any better. One of the goals that we do have is, if I am elected, you will have not only three representations from this area, but you have a fourth representation. And working together with the constituents, working together with the legislation, I believe we can get some things done. The goal is to make sure that everyone is represented, and that hasn't been done up to this point. A couple things too. We do need to make sure that our budget is on tap. We can't continue to raise taxes whenever we want. It was blatant this year that the leadership just broke the law and decided to raise taxes. This is what is wrong with Fulton County. We need a different direction in leadership.
Thank you. This is a topic that I happen to be very passionate about, and many of the people in this room are also passionate about. One of the most successful campaigns and in Fulton County's history and in the country's history was passing the library referendum. We had a master plan, we funded it, we're building libraries, there's one right here in Roswell being built. And yet, this session, we suddenly find that we are having to cut the hours to our libraries. Where would you find a funding source for restoring staffing levels and operating hours to county libraries, particularly in view of continuing construction of these new libraries? And let's start the question with Mr. Ellis.
Same word. Rosie.
Where would you find a funding resource?
No, I'm just asking about the word. Rosie.
Pardon?
Eric Broadwell.
Eric Broadwell. Okay. Let's start.
Not a problem. Libraries are also a big passion of mine. My kids all went to the Roswell Library here. They all went through the Tolerant Reading program that is now having been cut because of the library hours. And I'm the one who went to the library on a Friday when it was closed and brought a group of people with me, and we demonstrated. And we were on the front page of the local paper. We did that, and it was picked up by other current commissioners, and they're now trying to change some of those library hours. Where the funding's gonna come from, that would take a lot more detailed knowledge into where it is, but I can tell you with 5,000 employees here in the county, and right now the article in the AJC today was talking about the cut of the staff of the library. I think there's other areas that are more important, that are less important than the libraries, that we can look at in consolidating departments, such as there's 52 published departments on the Fulton County website. There's 82 actual departments I learned from Liz Hausman, and every department has their own HR person. Now, last time I worked in the corporate world, an HR person at IBM handled 2,500 to 3,000 people. I don't see why we have to have a huge HR department. So we start reducing staff, we'll have plenty of money, and we can also look at other budget cuts in other areas, and we will find the money, no problem, to fund the library. It was $3.9 million that they took out of it, and yet there are other areas that went up $6 and $12 million. And I think there's plenty of opportunity for that to be done.
Thank you very much. Mr. Cooper.
In trying to put my kids through college and finding the resources to do, I couldn't afford to pay for a lot of things. I was brought up in the days when you had those stack of encyclopedias. When I couldn't afford to upgrade that encyclopedia, the library was very important to me and my family. So I look at the libraries as being an essential thing. And it brings me to this point too, why am I running? I'm running because I feel that we need a government that respects the people. We went and voted, and we voted for libraries. And the Fulton County government took upon themselves to say, you know what, we don't care how you guys voted. We will cut the libraries. And I think that's wrong. I think we need leadership that will work with the people and make these things a priority. It's we have, where would the money come from? Well, first of all, I don't think it's a good thing that we have a tax commissioner that makes as much money as the president of the United States. And secondly, he has five members that make as much money, I just heard, than the judges. So those are areas we can cut. Another area where we can cut also is that we do need to look in technology. We are spending $23 million in technology, and technology is supposed to save us money, not cost us money. So we need to look in areas where we can make a difference. Thank you all for frowning up too when I'm not on the mic, because that is, you know, that he did the mic, but thank you very much. Hopefully you can hear me.
Thank you. And Mr. Ellis.
Sure. You know, one of the sad things about the budgetary process in Fulton County for the past several years, it follows a pretty similar pattern. They have a shortfall, they walk in, and they demagogue popular services. And I'll tell you one thing as a commissioner, I do not stand for that. It's inappropriate that we've demagogued libraries, senior services, and people try to use that for a political gain. It's unacceptable. From a standpoint of what we need to do, first and foremost, we've got to restore fiscal responsibility in this county. I want folks to understand, this last budget, $40 million shortfall, $50 million tax increase that's potentially illegal, so a $90 million shortfall. We've got a serious financial problem. That's why we wind up with these unpopular decisions about cutting library hours while we're going through an expansion. It's ridiculous. How do we go about addressing it? First and foremost, this county has mismanaged themselves in so many different ways. We've got an additional $18 million in cost in this year's budget related to additional litigation costs. 18, okay, on top of what we normally spend. This county's had some horrendous lawsuits, and we've got to manage that process better. Certainly automation, technology. We've got to get out of non-essential things and rent. We spent $5 million, built an amphitheater on the south end of town. It's in a flight path that we can't have concerts in, and we got a director there. That needs to go. Sell it. Do something with it. Things like that. Why we have a TV network in Fulton County, get rid of that. The thing with Fulton County, the tax commissioner, that's an opportunity too. There's duplicity of the opportunity to use technology and automation. Two-thirds of Fulton County employees turn in paper time cards. Opportunity for basically savings, as well as there's that opportunity that exists for fraud to exist as well. So there are just a lot of things we can do, and we've got to get to work doing.
Thank you.
Mr. Cooper.
Yes.
Do you support funding of Grady Hospital at current levels? And if not, why not?
Well, first of all, I'm not excited about the level of our funding Grady Hospital. Reason why is this. It's not fair that the CEO of Grady, with tax dollars, make over $1 million, including bonuses. That's with tax dollars. It's not fair that he has a staff that works with him that makes almost $500,000. Those things should not be happening with tax dollars. I also think that the state, when given the opportunity from, which was mentioned that they would want to play a role in it, the county neglected to allow them to be a part. I think we should give the state the opportunity to be a part in that funding process. And also, we should hold accountable the other areas that benefit, the other counties that benefit from that money. And then thirdly is this. One of the things that we haven't talked about is that there have been embezzlement cases against employees there. There is no one watching the money box. They don't let us know year to year who has been served. They don't have open records there. These are things that we need to change if they want to continue our support.
Thank you. Mr. Ellis, do you support funding of Grady Hospital at current levels?
So this year, Fulton County will contribute $61 million to Grady Hospital. $16 million of that for debt service, and the remainder is for indigent care. And that's a lot on a $625 million general fund budget. So I would like to see that come down. But I want to point out something to folks to understand. You know, for a lot of folks in this community, we don't touch and feel great. But if we ever have to touch and feel Grady, we're probably going to be pretty glad that it's there. It's pretty critical to this region. And I'm not going to demagogue this issue either, because it is a critical health resource for this region. If it goes away, we've got a lot of problems in the state. In 1997, this county was contributing $100 million to Grady. And we talk about private partnership models and using those things to be more efficient in government. Grady is a private partnership model today, okay? And that's why the difference in the spending. If we hadn't worked with the leaders across the county to get that done, there's no telling where we would be at today. We've got to make Grady more efficient, sure. And there's some opportunities for that. We need to look at ways to change their payor mix and be more profitable so that contribution can come down. 57% of the patients come from Fulton County, 32% come from DeKalb. Those two counties contribute, other counties don't. We need to work in ways with our state legislators to get other counties to contribute to bring that $61 million down.
Mr. Rockwell, how do you feel about supporting Grady Hospital?
You know, Grady is a really good asset. It is a level one trauma center, and so is Atlanta Medical Center right across the freeway. So everybody thinks Grady is the only level one trauma center, well, it's not. And Grady is a private nonprofit. It was about to close several years back because the county was managing the hospital, and it was fraught with corruption and all sorts of money issues. And we were still paying for it. Private money came in and said, unless it's a private hospital, we're not contributing. Because it's now a private nonprofit, they get a lot of private funds. Yes, it should be supported, but you know, if we keep paying for it, they're not going to need anybody else to help support them. We need to look at a full system, a statewide system of trauma centers that can help support this area. Atlanta Medical Center is owned by the same people that own North Fulton, which is a level two trauma center. We need to look at how we can get a level one trauma center here up in North Fulton, because if you get in an accident somewhere up north of here, you might not make it to Grady. I know when I passed out on my couch from the tachycardia, the ambulance came, they wouldn't take me to my hospital, they took me to North Fulton, because that's the shortest place to go. When that happens, that's what we need. We need a hospital local. So we need to look at how we're spending our money. And we need to make sure we're supporting an asset. We need to get the state involved. And that line item on the budget, that's why we have the tax increase. They claimed it was gonna go to employee raises. The tax increase and Grady and employee raises are all about the same. So if we look at that, we might be able to solve some more tax increases. Thank you.
Thank you.
This question starts with Bob Ellis. If the county commissioner hires a political consultant for their re-election, should that person's salary be paid for by taxpayers?
Read that one more time. No.
And actually, it says on this question, it's for District 7. So I guess the people that this question is directed to aren't in the room. So let's put that question aside.
Okay.
Let me give you a better question.
Let me begin by saying this. The people aren't in the room that replies to.
All right, so we're canning that question.
Well, you know, but that's a good question. And first of all, I do want it to be known that that question has some merit. And we, as voters, need to consider that. There are some things that's going on right now that is out of line.
Mr. Ellis, you get your chance to speak to that question.
So repeat it again.
The question was, if a county commissioner hires a political consultant for their re-election, should that person's salary be paid for by taxpayers?
Again, no. It's a clear no. No reason why that should be paid for by tax dollars.
And Mr. Brock?
I don't know if that's even legal, so I would say no.
Time for the AJC.
Yes.
Do some investigation. All right. So let's get to a real question, and we'll start with you, Mr. Ellis. How do you respond to someone who believes North Fulton taxpayers subsidize the rest of the county, yet do not receive commensurate services for the taxes that they pay?
Well, certainly, when you're out talking to people, you hear that a lot. I think at our last forum, our commission chair went on record and said the same. Am I correct, guys?
Yeah.
So, that is a reality. I don't think the answer is that we spend more money. I think the answer is that we look at how we're providing all of our services across the county and find ways to provide those services at a low cost. Again, we've got to restore fiscal responsibility, period. We've got to operate with a balanced budget. Are there inequities in terms of services? Sure. Are there some places where there probably will continue to be some inequities in services based upon the needs in the lower part of the county than in the northern part of the county? Probably so. And we probably, for Northville's sake, probably hope that continues to be the case, because that makes our quality of life maybe a little bit better than what we have on the south side. But we can't waste money, and that's the key thing. We can't waste money on spending things like building this $5 million amphitheater or building an aeronautical museum that we don't need. Those are the things that we need to eliminate in terms of inequities of services or facilities on opposite ends of the county.
Thank you. Mr. Brockwell.
Yes, the money does flow south. And Bob's correct in this, what John Eaves said at our last forum. He said a lot of things that I was surprised that he admitted to. There's definitely a lot of taxes that are flowing south. One thing we need to look at is where the tax money's coming from and how it's getting spent, right? So we want to understand that. So we need to maybe do a report based on districts of how much tax revenue is coming from the district and how much tax money is being spent in that district. And maybe we should even look at how we tax ourselves accordingly. Maybe if we lower our taxes in the areas where they're not getting some services, obviously there's baseline services such as judicial and others, but maybe we look at that additional tax, maybe we bring that down based on a per district need, and maybe we look at it that way. That's one way to cut the money. So we need to look at various ways. We need to be creative. We need to take some experience and look at how we cut the budget, how we bring that tax down so the money's not flowing south, because it is flowing south. The parks are in the south, the amphitheater's in the south, the unincorporated area down there in the south. You know, you look at Cobb County, it's got more unincorporated area than any county. What's their sales tax? 6%, less than ours. What's their tax? Less than ours. It's just unbelievable. And I can tell you, I've experienced that. Again, my property was half cut, half full, and my services didn't change, but my taxes went up.
Thank you.
Question again.
Mr. Cooper, how do you respond to someone who believes North Fulton taxpayers subsidize the rest of the county, yet do not receive commensurate services for the taxes that they have paid?
I would agree with him. I would agree with him, yes, it does. But some of the things that we do need to focus on is that we need to be able to make sure that we focus in under the leadership that I believe in, is that our leadership needs to say, hey, we need to bring South Fulton up. We need to make sure that South Fulton schools graduate kids. We need to make sure that the South Fulton area be more responsible in the areas that they need to be responsible. We can't have, we need to make sure up here that we have the senior care that's needed in this area. We need to, what has happened is this, I've talked to a lot of the mayors in this area. There's no communication with leadership at all. Leadership doesn't come up. They don't have a regular annual meeting of any sorts. They only focus in on the South. That's one of the great things about having these two running. That will give a third person, and me being the fourth, when I went, that we can all work together to make sure that this becomes one county and not two counties.
Thank you very much.
And keeping with our schedule, Mr. Broadwell, Mr. Ellis, and Mr. Cooper, this will be the final question. I think this is the one you've all been waiting for. We'll start with Eric Broadwell. Eric, how would you balance the Fulton County budget?
Just as I balance my budget on my kitchen table. There are many, many areas. Obviously, I can tell you at KBMC, we were overstaffed and our budget was very large. We were charging our customers electric rates just very high. We were one of the most expensive electric rates in the state. I took over as chairman of the finance committee and I said, we're gonna get rid of some of these expenses and we're gonna bring it down. First thing I did when I got in there is those put in some governance and I enacted term limits, which I'm the only candidate talking about term limits for the commissioners. The other thing I did is I said, with my IT background, we're an electric company, we're not an IT company, let's outsource that. We're saving $7 million a year because of that. The same thing can happen at the county. There's 186 IT applications, $23 million worth of expenses. I can tell you that's outrageous for the amount of services we should be providing. There is no reason for any of that. That is one area. You start looking at why, where we can cut with basically certain types of employees. We have landscapers on staff. Why? Why are we outsourcing that? We can hold people accountable much easier if we outsource it or privatize it better than we can manage it ourselves and have the HR burden, the employee burden, the tax burden, and everything else. It's much better if you privatize it and bring that down. There's a lot of areas that are open. It's a big green field. You're going to hear lots of opportunities. And Grady's another area that's an opportunity. We can bring that down and we can do what's right and try to raise up Grady and bring a more comprehensive approach to everything and take the leadership to where we need to be.
Mr. Cooper, how would you balance the Fulton County budget?
First of all, when you look at the budget, compared to last year, this budget is $100 million over last year's budget. So that's an indication right there that there was no budget cut. When you look at the things that got cut, libraries got cut, senior service, which is human services, got cut, and the arts got cut, and family and children services were the only things that got cut, things that are actually the constituents need. There weren't any other cuts there. We need to get to the point of making our managers more responsible. We don't need to be asking at the ninth hour on December 18th is when the question was asked, had any of our leaders, any of the managers looked at cutting the budget when the budget is due at the beginning of January. These are areas that we need to make sure that leadership says that these things need to be handled. I don't want to, my opponents aren't here, and I don't want to demagogue their leadership, but I will say we need a new direction is what we need there. The other services is this. We can't, as I said before, we can't have our district attorney spending millions of dollars just on meetings and vacations with staff. Those are areas where we really need to make sure that there is an oversight there. And that's what we haven't had. We haven't had a leader or a commission group that would say, let's make sure that we are responsible first, and then we can lead from that direction.
Hey, the way I look at it, if they're not here, go ahead and demagogue them. Mr. Evans, how would you balance the Fulton County budget?
Sure. Again, this is the key issue. You know, before you talk about tax relief, you gotta balance the budget. We got a big shortfall. I took the opportunity to go down and sit with finance director and his team and try to understand the different nuances and make sure I had a good understanding of it in addition to what I read in all the packets of material. I've had firsthand experience of cutting budgets myself, so my opponent's wrong on that. He's the only person here. I've been in the corporate world and had to work through those things. You know, I mentioned before, there's an opportunity in the risk management area. We've got an additional, that's a big chunk of change, an additional $18 million on top of what we have normally spent. County's largely self-insured. I provide insurance specifically in this area, and I look at the loss cost base and the size of this organization, and it's excessive. Talk about the non-essential facilities we got in. You gotta look at all, anytime you get into cost-cutting initiatives, you look at your whole facilities. Are there opportunities to get out of leases? You know, facilities that you don't need, different non-essential services, mention an amphitheater, et cetera. We also have to look at the revenue side, not from an increased tax standpoint, but we've got to make sure that our tax assessor's office has got to have tax assessments up to date and that they are fair. And I think there's an opportunity there for looking at the numbers and talking with folks. Reductions in force. We need to have a really robust job re-justification process, and the county manager really needs to go about implementing that. That's an easy way, quick way to save money when you're dealing with turnover. Have each of those departments come back and have a strong re-justification process, and you let go of the jobs unless they can truly justify. You go through all of that, you can look at grading, maybe there's some opportunities there for grading to save money as well. And that's how you get to a balanced budget. But make no bones about it. Cutting expenses is tough, and this is going to be a tough thing to do, is balance this budget going forward.
Thank you.
We're going to stay on the final question. Actually, it's not a question. You're going to get a 1 minute wrap up, but I want to add something to the discussion we just had as a point of information for people. At a recent meeting of the Fulton County School Superintendent's Advisory Group, we learned that the Fulton County Tax Assessor's Office had indicated that there would be a 0.5% growth in the tax digest. The reason for that was simply that they did not have enough staff to reassess properties. And compared to Gwinnett County's 7-8% growth and Cobb County's equal growth in Atlanta, also the same amount of growth. I'm just referencing that point because there's actually money in the digest to support a larger budget. The reason this is important is that Fulton County school system relies on the funds that are gathered from Fulton County taxes as well, the digest. So Mr. Cooper, to the point you made about Fulton County schools in the South, the school system is responsible for the schools, not the Fulton County Commission. So I wanted to speak to that because the school system raises its money, and it's very important that we understand who has control of that. I had a question that just came up here. In Cobb County, seniors over 65 are exempt from school taxes. Would you support this exemption for Fulton seniors? I know this is asked a lot of times, but actually that is not necessarily the purview of the county commission. That's the school system's purview. So you need to bring that up with your school board members, whoever asked this question, and that's another topic. So let's do the wrap up now. And we'll do the wrap up in reverse order. So you have 1 minute each, starting with Mr. Broadwell.
Thank you, Lynn. So as you look at this race, especially here at District 2, there's two of us. What you have to look at is you have to look at who has experience, who has proven conservative values, who is going to get out there and is going to actually work for you. You can look at my record. I was elected to the board of Cobb EMC. I affected many people's wallets, Edenwild, Litchfield, Wildwood Springs, my neighborhood in Steeplechase. All those neighborhoods are served by my electric company that I serve on the board as chairman of the finance committee. I sit there and I oversee a $426 million budget. I actually go through the process of budgeting. We look through where there are ways to cut. That is what you need in a commissioner, somebody who can spend your money wisely. And you know from how I feel about services such as libraries, that I will do the right thing. I serve on the Roswell Ethics Committee, and I appreciate, and I would ask for your vote on May 20th.
Thank you, Mr. Broadwell. Mr. Ellis.
Sure. Thank you all again. You know, my campaign slogan, my website is Fix Fulton, and that's not some trite expression. That's my mission and that's my focus. This county has been dysfunctional for far too long, and we've got a great opportunity before us with new representation to make a difference, and I am committed to that. From an experience standpoint, you know, I'm in charge of an $800 million budget. I put it together each year. I deal with the cost. I work with tons of people on that. That's a role I've had to play for years. I know what that's like. You know, I know what it's like to trade offs with people, to negotiate with people. And when I started campaigning, I didn't start as anybody's sponsored candidate. As I've gone around, tons of people have been willing to come on and support me, and I've just been honored by that. And I just ask for your vote on May 20th. We've got a great opportunity before us, and with your vote, I would love the opportunity to serve you with integrity and with honor. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Ellis. And Mr. Cooper, your final minute.
Well, first of all, I thank you all. Being the vice chairman of the Fulton Republican Party, I recognize that there are some difficulties that the party brings forward. But one of the things that I admire about the party is that we try to work together. We try to work together with all people to make sure that the party represents its original mission. My goal as leader is that we need to make sure that the commissioners work together to fulfill what the constituents have asked for. That's the type of leadership that we need. One of the things I've done, I didn't really get into my resume at a later date, please stop me and shake hands and talk over it. The county spent $1.5 million on a youth program. And if you need to be very important, especially with that being our future. And I took that same program that they did, got together with some friends. They reached 150 kids, we reached 300 kids. We need to make sure that our leadership stand tall and stop.
Thank you all. And let's give these candidates a round of applause. The informed voter is the best voter. And ladies and gentlemen, please don't forget to tell your friends and neighbors to vote. Early voting has started. Thank you to Hal Coleman for being a great moderator and great jokes.
We were told to end this thing at 9 o'clock, and I want you to know it's now 9:11.
Thank you.
Now, those of you would be happy.
Thanks for coming.